Just a second. Okay, that's work.
Good. Oh, but
okay.
There's some gray splotch on your screen on the right.
Yeah, because it's not the not the full screen, but that's intentional.
No, there's something else happening. It looks like there's a window covering part. There we go.
It's closed. It's okay. Now close it. Now can you see it
yes.
Full? Okay,
yes,
very good.
Okay.
Thank you.
So Our next speaker is Carlo Sano from Torino, who speaks on membership in random ratio sets.
Okay. Hello, everybody. So I start thanking the organizers for this opportunity to speak. And I'll say a couple of things about random ratio sets. So let n be a positive integer and alpha be between 0 and 1. We denote by b and alpha the probabilistic model in which a random set A is constructed by picking independently each element of 1, 2, dots n with probability alpha. And several number theoretic objects involving these random sets have been studied, including, for example, the least common multiple of the elements of A, the sum set A plus A, the product set A times A, and finally the ratio set A over A, which is the set of all fractions having numerator and denominator both in A. Particular regarding random ratio sets, Sileruero e Guglielmo Ordonez gave this result. Let A be a random set in the model B and alpha. Then if we keep fixed alpha and we let n go into infinity, we have this asymptotic formula for the cardinality of the random ratio set. Which holds almost surely. Here we have the definition of an asymptotic formula holding with probability 1 minus small o 1. Anyway, the idea is that the probability that these two quantities are close in ratio goes to 1. And in this formula, we can see the logarithm function. A fundamental step in the proof is determining the probability that certain rational numbers R over X belongs to the random ratio set. In particular, they showed that if R is less than S and they are coprime with S greater than the square root of N, then the probability that R over X belong to the random ratio set is given by this formula. Let's note that the assumption that the numerator is less than the denominator is not a restriction because X belong to the random ratio set if and only if X to the minus one belongs to the random ratio set. However, the assumption that the denominator is large is indeed a restriction. So I thought about a general formula for this probability. And this is the result I got. Let A be a random ratio set. Then the probability that the rational number R over X belong to the random ratio set is given by this formula where we have a product involving a second order linear recurrence depending on alpha. Particularly if alpha is 1/2, then the second order linear recurrence beta essentially is a normalized version of Fibonacci numbers. With this result, it follows quite easily this corollary, which shows that the probability is essentially 1 minus an exponential in n, where this infinite series depend on the denominator. A natural generalization would be, instead of considering the probability that a rational number belongs to the random ratio set, the joint probability that several rational numbers belong to the random ratio set, or that this joint probability, the things are equivalent. However, this is much more complex, and I'll say more things later. Anyway, I was able to get this partial generalization, which gives the disjoint probability that the powers of a certain fixed rational number belongs to the random ratio set. Here, the exponents of the powers belong to a set E, which is either a finite or a cofinite set of positive integers containing the number 1. And here it appears a linear recurrence beta j depending both on the set E and alpha. Okay, now I'm going to give a brief sketch of the proof. These results are quite elementary. However, I hope that later I'll give you some open problems which might be of your interest. So the idea to prove the first result, so the formula for the probability that a rational number belongs to the random ratio set, is to consider a graph, a direct graph, whose vertices are the number from 1 to n, and we have an edge, a direct edge, from Rt to St, for all positive integer t less than n over x. So essentially, two vertices are connected if their ratio is r over x. And here we have a special case, an example, with n equal 30, r equal 2, and s equal 3. Now, what happens? That two direct edges of this graph with t less than t prime have a common vertex if and only if st is equal to rt prime. This is quite easy to see by checking the four possible common vertices. This is the only possible one. And therefore, since R and S are coprime, we get that T is equal to RU and T prime is equal to SU for some positive integer U. And the two direct edges form this direct path. Iterating this reasoning, one gets that all the direct paths of this graph have this structure where the power of R are decreasing and the power of S are increasing. Furthermore, it's not too difficult to show that each vertex is incident to at most two edges. Hence, it turns out that the connected component of this graph are all direct path graph. And so they have a linear structure. These are the connected components of the previous graph, and you can see that they have all a linear structure. Now, there's a kind of double counting argument. Let D sub I be the number of direct paths of the graph consisting of exactly I vertices. By the previous reasoning, we have this formula for T sub I because we can pick U in at most about N over S to the I. Also, let C sub I be the number of connected components consisting of exactly I vertices. What we have is that each connected component of I vertices contains exactly I minus j plus one direct path of j vertices. And so if we do the double counting, we get these equations relating C sub I and D sub J. And this is a system, a linear system in unknown C sub one, C sub two, etc. With a bit of patience, one can solve this linear system, getting this formula for C sub I in terms of D sub I. And now we know essentially all we need. What is the relation between this graph and the probability that a rational number belongs to the set? Well, we have that R over S belongs to the random ratio set if and only if there exists a positive integer t less than n over s, such that both rt and st belongs to A. Therefore, the probability that R over S does not belong to the random ratio set is the probability of these disjoint events, where AB is the event that neither A nor B belongs to A. And these events are in natural correspondence with the edges of the graph. By the way, this is very convenient because E stands both for event and for edges. In particular, events corresponding to edges of different connecting components are independent because they share no common vertices. And if M sub one, M sub two, etc., is a connected component of the graph, then the probability of the events corresponding to the edges is equal to the probability that the string M sub one, M sub two, etc., has no consecutive elements belonging to A. And this is an easy exercise in probability to show that this probability is satisfy a second order linear recurrence, which is the one defining beta sub I. One can prove this by induction. And we have everything because the probability that R over X does not belong to the random ratio set is the product over the connecting component, because they are independent, of these probabilities, which are beta to the C sub I, the number of vertices, and we know C sub I and D sub I, so these some computations, and we get the desired result. Of course, this is the complementary event, so we have to do one minus this product. So this was the sketch of the ideas. And now, as I mentioned, I'd like to pose some problems, which are quite natural, I believe. As I mentioned before, a natural question is asking for the probability of the disjoint event that some rational numbers, more than one, belongs to the random ratio set. This amount to study the graph obtained by the union of the previous graph for the rational numbers R sub I, S sub I. Precisely, one has to classify the connecting components of this graph and determine the probability that each of them does not have two adjacent vertices belonging to A. If the multiplicative group generated by these rational numbers is cyclic, then the connected components have a somehow linear structure, and so computations are similar to the one I showed you before. This is the reason why I was able to get a result regarding powers of a fixed rational number because the multiplicative group is cyclic. However, if this is not the case, so these rational numbers generate a group with a rank greater than one, then the connecting components are isomorphic to a subgraph of the R-dimensional grid graph. And here, just some picture, for example, if we have two rational numbers, 2/3 and 3/4, this is the graph, and these are the connected components which have some loops, and so they are more difficult to classify and to study. And this is another example. Okay, and another problem is regards visible lattice points. For every integer d greater than one, we let this a to the d be the set of lattice points in n to the d, which are visible in a to the d. This means that the line segment from the origin to the point P intersect A to the D only in the point. There is a natural bijection between the visible points of A squared with the ratio set of A, which is given by sending the couple of points to their ratio. Siliroero e Guiardo Ordonez gave an asymptotic formula for the cardinality of the visible points of A to the D for a random set A in the same model as before. So I wonder what is the formula for the probability that a fixed point is visible in A to D. This amount to study the hypergraph whose vertices are the integers from 1 to n and whose hyperedges are essentially the multiple of the coordinates of the point. And here we have, for example, this hypergraph for n equal to 28 and the point of coordinates 2, 3, 4. And here the connected components get more difficult, and also the fact that this is an hypergraph, so it's more complex than uninvolved, more involved than a direct graph. Bye-bye, so that's all for me. Thank you for your attention. Here we have some references. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Carlo. Do we have any questions for our speaker? Don't see anything in the chat. So, Carlo, thank you again. Very nice. And our next talk is in 10 minutes.